I'm happy to be joined by Esther Krofah, Executive Director of FasterCures, a center within the Milken Institute that focuses on accelerating solutions for biomedical research and always putting patients at the center of the equation. Through her work leading FasterCures, Esther is at the forefront of the latest therapeutic and vaccine development in the race for solutions in fighting COVID-19. Esther, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you for having me.
So let's dive in. Given your role in the industry, you get to look across the entire landscape of drug development, and specifically in this context, at programs targeting SARS-CoV-2/COVID-19. And as we see in this first chart that we show, you are tracking nearly 200 treatment candidates. Can you lead us into the discussion today by characterizing the breadth of the undertaking, where we are in the progress, and maybe a little bit of the road ahead?
Sure, absolutely. Marshall, when we first started tracking the development of treatments and vaccines in early March, there were really just a few dozen compounds that we were tracking. And just as you stated, we now have over 200 treatments that we're tracking. Then we'll talk a bit more on the vaccine side in a little bit later. From a treatment perspective, we're so encouraged to see all of the different efforts related to the development of antibody treatments, antiviral treatments, cell-based treatments, et cetera. And just as you've asked, there have been quite a number of promising developments along the lines of treatments. And we expect to see, hopefully in the next few months, some treatments come forward for COVID, certainly before we see a vaccine or around the same time. Early on, we saw data coming out on remdesivir that showed moderate improvement for that therapeutic for hospitalized patients. Right now, we are tracking over 65% of treatments that are either in phase two or in phase three treatments. And I think that's important because we know that there are a number of scanning programs underway to look across libraries for what could be effective, but we have good data that are indicating that they're good treatment compounds to be studied. Those that we find most promising, antibody studies like Regeneron's that we'll hear a little bit more about, either those that have been engineered and can be effective for patients, or those that are recovered from convalescent patients. Some early data indicates that the convalescent plasma could be beneficial and have efficacy for patients. We're also studying compounds that are addressing ARDS or the cytokine storm, which really severely affects hospitalized patients and leads to potentially really terrible outcomes. There are a number of compounds that are being studied, either peptide inhibitors, IL-6 compounds that can address the inflammation. It's interesting that a number of cancer researchers are also looking at potential therapies from oncology that can be repurposed for COVID-19. For example, some researchers are looking at prostate cancer therapies like Degarelix, for example, to look at the TMPRSS2 protein and potentially inhibiting that protein. And so there are a number of efforts underway. I do think what we're going to see eventually is that it's not going to be just a one therapy solution, but rather a combination solution that will come to market. We have a number of platform clinical trials like Recovery in the UK, like Solidarity led by the WHO, that are looking at potentially these combination therapies that are going to be studied either antivirals with a combination of anti-inflammatory drugs.
That's super helpful. Let's maybe dive a little bit deeper into some of those categories. Let's start first by talking about the antivirals. You referenced remdesivir. You noted the encouraging data that they put out, the authorization that they received from the agency. Have we seen any additional data coming out from Gilead and the remdesivir work? And are there any other antivirals that you're tracking most closely to potentially add to the arsenal of antiviral therapy?
Yes, so as we all saw in late April, there was a report by the NIH ACT study, which was an adaptive design randomized study that showed that moderate improvement that was helpful to see. Since then, the NIH has actually launched on May 8th, the ACT 2 study that is focused on combining remdesivir with an anti-inflammatory compound. Because that first study was stopped early because of the early promising data, we did not have data on a potential impact on mortality. And so this second study, the Act II study, is intended to evaluate whether remdesivir is effective against mortality, as well as if any additional benefits can be derived for patients from that combination perspective. Gilead, on June 1st, of course, reported their top line study that showed that the five-course treatment was better than placebo. I expect, as we see remdesivir as part of standard of care and as the control arm to some of these platform studies, additional data will come forward.
So second question regarding convalescent plasma. So the concept and the early data would suggest it's promising in this context. How does the underlying epidemiology affect the ability to source supply? And do you see convalescent plasma playing a central role going forward, given that other therapeutics will be coming online and hopefully over the next several months?
Yes, well, we have seen the American Red Cross step up to collect plasma from patients that have recovered from COVID-19 or 14 days symptom-free. Mayo Clinic is actually leading the FDA expanded access program, collecting convalescent plasma from patients. They have recently reported, based on observational study of 5,000 patients who received infusions, that therapy is potentially safe. We do need randomized control trials to determine whether it's efficacious, but knowing that it is safe, I think, is a good first step. Right now, they're tracking that over 21,000 patients have been infused with convalescent plasma. I think that's going to be part of the arsenal of treatments going forward. As you talked about, Marshall, in terms of the supply, we're relying on individuals who are able to volunteer to go in and have and donate their plasma, essentially. So while this will be added to the slew of treatment options, it's not necessarily going to be that therapeutic that will be available to everyone everywhere, because we're going to, at some point, hit a supply issue. Some of the other participating hospitals and even the Mayo Clinic study have also reported early data that patients may be recovering a little bit sooner from use of that plasma. So I do think that it's an important part of what we have and what we use. I don't necessarily think that that is going to be the solution for everything.
So before we go to vaccines, two last questions here on therapeutics. We're going to talk about antibodies in a little bit when we talk with Dr. Schleifer. But are there any other particular exciting new modalities in the therapeutic space? And then can you characterize the calendar this summer in terms of programs underway and when we'd expect, you know, a body of clinical data reading out, likely through the latter part of the summer into the fall? And what are the implications of that?
Yeah. Well, there are other therapies and other modalities, as you mentioned. So cell-based therapy is another modality that is being examined. The ability to transplant stem cells, potentially for individuals who are severely ill. That is early right now in clinical research. As we look over the next several months, what we expect to see is that phase two, phase three data begin to read out, hopefully by the end of the summer into early fall. We should have some either emergency use authorizations by the FDA with a number of these studies as they begin to report that data, and or we continue on with evaluation into 2020 and early 2021. I expect that the timeline may align actually with the vaccine timeline. We'll talk a little bit about that with some of those programs that have really made significant progress. But as I look across the summer, I see a lot of enrollment happening in terms of these studies right now. I think enrollment will close early this summer. We should get some good data by the end of the summer into early fall.
Excellent. So let's shift to vaccines. As we put up the next chart, you're tracking over 100 vaccines. Where are we right now in terms of clinical development? Can you characterize further the progress on that front?
Yes, so I think we tracked 163 vaccine candidates as of Friday when we looked across our data. 10 of them are in clinical testing, which is fantastic to see. We have a number of programs all around the world, in China, in Europe, and then here in the U.S. as well. Two of the leading programs, as we all know, are Moderna's mRNA vaccine, as well as the University of Oxford's vaccine, and they are now entering a partnership with AstraZeneca to scale up the manufacturing of their vaccine. So we expect that we'll see more individuals enrolled into the phase two studies. So both of those vaccines are now in phase two studies. Likelihood of Moderna entering phase three studies by July. So that's where that stands. So it's quite promising to see how much progress has been made over a short period of time.
As it relates to Moderna, as well as Oxford, you know, they've pointed to potentially having vaccine available and approved potentially later this year at a smaller scale, probably for frontline workers and other parts of the population that are at risk, and then potentially at a broader scale of availability into early next year. Can you characterize, is that likely? Is that aspirational? Give our audience a calibration as to the probability of meeting those forecasts.
Well, for anyone who follows vaccine development, and I had a chance to work at GSK, so have some insight into that in terms of working with a large vaccine manufacturer, it typically takes up to 10 years and at times over $1 billion in order to produce a vaccine. So the timetables that we're seeing right now, 12, potentially 18 months, is actually quite aggressive. And optimistic in some ways. I do think, based on where these vaccines stand from a clinical development perspective, that if everything continues to go smoothly and as data is reported out, that we may likely see the vaccine in that short period of time that you've talked about. Moderna did get a head start. Moderna, working alongside the NIH researchers, was able to, within 48 hours after the Chinese researchers revealed the sequencing, they were able to turn around a potential vaccine candidate, 42 days later go into clinical trials, leveraging their technology that they were studying with NIH from MERS. And so that head start, I think, has been actually quite helpful for them. We have seen a number of these other approaches catch up as well, but I do think the 12 to 18 month timeline is optimistic. I think there's a couple of things we need to keep in mind. One thing is the production and development timeline, which may meet the 12 to 18 month process, particularly as companies are going at risk to scale manufacturing in this concurrent fashion, which typically follows a phase one, phase two, phase three study. The other thing that we need to keep in mind is that we need to have a rollout timeline, a rollout and access timeline to set public expectation. What I am seeing that concerns me a bit is when we talk about a vaccine is available in potentially 12 months, everyone might think they'll have access to that vaccine, communicating very clearly that there's going to be rollout either to frontline healthcare workers and potentially the elderly, those who are immunocompromised and others. Having the right expectations for the public, I think, is quite critical.
Such helpful perspective, Esther. Thank you so much for taking the time. It's very encouraging, and thank you for all that you do at FasterCures. It for sure is making a great difference. Thank you very much.